Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Julie Wilson.
In Florida, where I was working out, called Mother Kelly's. Did you ever go there? You're too young. That was down in Miami Beach, and they served us fabulous thumb bits, little pieces of sirloin steak on little pieces of toast, with a wonderful sauce in the dish in the middle. And all the big stars came: Judy Garland, Martha Ray, the Rich Brothers, Hildegard. And they all came over and just chowed down, chowed down. And it was wonderful for them. Then they just kept on talking. I got madder and madder. But there was nothing I could do. I tried everything. The only thing, when I did this song, a friend of mine who was an agent said, try it. Pearlie may go care. And she did it. He didn't care. And we used to wave together in the parades. We were a wonderful team. This was one of her biggies. Tired of the life I lead. Tired of the blues I breathe. Tired counting things I need. I'm gonna truck downtown, spend my move, get some short vamp shoes, and a new guy. Tired of the clothes I wear. Tired of the patches there. Tired of the crows I scare. Not why, that's the truth. Get a brand new guy. Well, I got by you. Washer and a tugger, cleaner and a scrubber, sure leaves my glamour with a scar, a mender and a mopper, scotching and shopping. Don't make me look like no Hedy Lamarr. Remember her? Tired. The tears I shed. Tired of living in the red. I'm tired of the same old bed. Gonna live the life like Cindy Lou. Gonna do the things that I know she'd do. I'm tired, mighty tired. Well, I learned one thing tonight. They don't want a nice girl from Omaha, Nebraska. They want a little bitchy babe. So, Carrie Kelsey, you remember that. Besides being blonde and beautiful, you're gonna be bitchy, baby. All right. It's amazing how we learn this. Now, this is kind of an old-fashioned one, so. A pianist friend of mine in Chicago gave it to me years ago, and I never did it. And I was surprised that other people didn't seem to do the song either. And it was one of those lovely little, wonderful, precious songs. All it needed was someone to sing it. And try to sing it. And the music is by the wonderful Jerome Kern. And the lyrics were by a woman called Anne Caldwell. And Chris Denny made a lovely arrangement. Men are called deceivers, ever. And women flirt with passion. One true love that lasts forever is sadly out of fashion. Moonlit madness under a pale sky. Flames that burn to ashes and then die. Lips. Oh, sorry, Johnny. Thank you. Oh, he knows him better than I do. All too soon, the lips that kiss may learn to say goodbye. I want to say ciao, baby. Once in a blue moon, you will meet the right one. Once in a blue moon, you'll find your dear, the light one. Then, with a thrill, you'll know that love is true.
Yeah.
thoughts are strong for somebody else. Yes, the hands I hold belong to somebody else. Well, I bet they're not so cold. I should have realized he'd be a married man. Why did I buy those new Before our big affair began, before I knew where I was at, I found myself upon the shelf, and that was that. I'll have to crawl right back and into my shell. She was Miss America and Miss Universe. Imagine at 15. Her name is Dorothy Dale. And Lou Spence sent me this song. He said, I think you should do it, Julie. So I learned it. And at my age, it's hard to learn. Well, it is so loud. You think it's fun. Well, it is fun, but it's hard. Anyway, this was performed by Dorothy Dale. Yes, did you ever know Dorothy Dale? I didn't know. I wish I had. And she won a contest for having the most perfect back. Man, I didn't really worry about back. All I care about now are fronts. I have nothing to worry about. But anyway, Dorothy was given this song to sing, and Lorenz and Florence's Flo Springfield's Last Follies that he produced in 1931. When? Oh, I forgot to tell you, I'm gonna live till I die.
Yes, John.
The song was done, that's the same year this kid was born. And I want you to notice, the older I get, the younger and more attractive my accomplishment. Why not? I enjoy it. Anyway, this was Dorothy's song. I wish I'd seen this little lady. Then she, a year later, she was in the Follies, and by this time she's 16. And this is her song. It's about a sweet young thing of 16 who thought she'd step out one night alone and get the thrills in life that she had missed. She met a youth, a bit uncouth, but still, he seemed all right. She'd known him but a moment when they kissed. And when she woke up next day with swollen head, and her girlfriend asked, "Did you have fun?" This is what she said. "Was I drunk? Was he handsome? And did my mom give me hell? Did I get a thrill? And am I still a quiver? Was he rough? Did I care?
Boy, I'm often glad
I fell. Each time I think about it, do I shiver? Oof. Was he hot? And was I? And would he stand for maybe? He would not. Would I lie? Does he still think I'm a baby? If I was, am I still? Do I care? But don't we still? Was I drunk? Was he handsome? And did my mom give me help? Was he, no, was I drunk? Was he handsome? And did my mom give me help? Why,
boy,
were his hands loose. There was no use refusing. Did he bite? Did I bruise? Why, I'm most ashamed to tell. I still don't know what system he was using. I said, stop, please behave. But when I started raving, he said, give. So I gave. After all, what was I saving? Was I glad? Boy, was I glad. Was I what? Had. Huh? Oh, holy gee. Holy gee, was I had? You're asking me. Was I drunk? Was he handsome? And did my mom give me hell? Boy, did she. On Mulligan's stew. I love stew. And never wished for turkey. As I hitched and hiked and drifted too from Maine to Albuquerque. Alas, I missed the Bozarts ball. Why did you come down here? And what is twice as sad, I was never at a party where the honored noble come. But social circles spin too fast for me. My home Bohemia, like Omaha, is the place to be. I get too hungry for dinner at 8. I love to see other women, but never come late. I never bother with people I hate. That's what the lady has to try. I don't like crap games with barons and earls. Won't go to Harlem in unmanned pearls. Won't kiss the dirt with the rest of the girls. That's why the lady is a trap. Smith, read every line. That's why the lady is a tramp. I like a prize fight that isn't a fake. I love the rowing on Central Park Lake. I go to opera, stay wide awake. That's why the lady is a tramp. I love the green grass. Under my shoes, what can I lose? I'm flat, that's sad. I'm all alone when I lower my lamp. That's why the lady thought, but my shape is my own. That's why the lady is a trap. My mother taught me before I was 10. I learned my lesson again and again. Now I can separate the boys from the men. That's why the lady is a trap. Friend.
So great.
Rain in my face. Diamonds and lace. You got so what for Frank Sinatra? I whistle and stand. That's why the lady. That's why this lady. That's why the lady is a
bravo. Oh, bravo.
Was a gift, someone, a wonderful musician who's no longer with us, a wonderful young man, so handsome and so kind. And he liked the fact that I was sorting it out down in Miami Beach. And he said, Julie, you should do the ballad that I always think of. And with you, you should do it. He said it was a big hit song. And I didn't know it. And so he got me a copy. And his uncle was a piano player in Frank Sorrell's trio. Don't ask me how I remember that name. I spent all my money on arrangements. Yeah, you're laughing. I only made $165. But that's okay. I learned lots of lessons. But this was written by Henry Nemo. You can have my castle. That's it. I had a castle. I would miss it for just a while. You could have my treasure. That's if I had a treasure. I face poverty with a smile. But there's one thing I ask of you. One thing you must never do. Tear a star from out the sky. And the sky feels blue. Tear a petal from a rose. Your heart away from mine, and mine will surely break. My life is yours to make, so please keep the spark awake. Would you take the wings from birds so that they can fly? Would you take the ocean's roar and leave just a sigh? This your heart So this is what I beg of you. Don't take your love from me.
Oh, bravo.
This was something that she wrote with a very good performer, pianist, composer, Ronnie White. He's been around a while. And I'll just test you with the title. If he were straight and I were young. If he were straight and I were young and both by Cupid's arrow stung, what movie magic spun by fate if I were young and he were straight. If he were straight, our eyes would meet and linger for a longer beat. If he admired the clothes I wear, he wouldn't hold that we would share. Still, this is a fantasy. He's who he is, and I am me. But that's not how this story ends. There's an old line. Can't we be friends? But if I were young as once before and hung my hopes around his door, what fervent flames we might have flung if he were straight and I were young. This sudden hunger. He can't get straight. He probably doesn't want to a bit. I can't get younger. I'd love it, but that won't say. But all one loves songs might be so. If he were straight.
Bravo.
musician friend of mine when it was cut out of the show of Stephen Sondheim's Follies in Boston. And he just sent me the music and said, have fun, Julie. And I did. I know this. Boy's a jerk. They have my blessing. But when he starts to move, he aims to please, which only goes to prove that sometimes in a clerk you find a herc, Ulysses. He hasn't much. That's plus. You might describe him thus. A false alarm. A broken arm. An imitation Hitler. And with Littler charm. But oh, can that boy Fox try? His mouth is mean. He's not too clean. What makes him look reptilian is the brilliant. But oh, can that boy not drop? No. What I saw in him, I took a chance. Oh yes. One more flaw in him. He can't dance. As dumbbells go, he's rather slow. And as for being saintly, even faintly, no. But who needs Albert Schweitzer when the lights are low? And oh boy, can that boy fart? Of him. He's all sound. His jokes are quaint and very faint. He may be full of hokum, but I've no complaint. He often is a boy, but on the floor, he ain't. And oh boy, can that boy fox trot? Oh, this is another gift. This was given to me by a fabulous comic. Joey Lewis.
Joey Lewis.
Oh, what a following that kid had. I tell you, he did so magnificently, especially considering that the mob had slit his throat in Chicago and left him to die in the gutter. He didn't. He was amazing. He just had that big scar on his face where they cut him up and then they cut his vocal cords. And he had a growly voice, but so did B.S. Bowie. Oh, somebody remembers B.S. But that Joey was the sweetest man. He never forgot a soul. He had some following, that kid. And he called me up shortly after he'd had a bad stroke and he couldn't get up on those wonderful, funny legs of his. And he said, Julie, I want you to meet me at Dutch's restaurant. Free dinner. Brian. And it was delicious. Oh, he had the best food. All the athletes hung out there. It's a great place. Toots was an adorable man. And so he said, Eli Bass, with all his specialty. He said, I want you to go to Julie's place tomorrow and take her. The stock market's on. So he said, okay, Joe. And the next day I got the song. It's about a lady who has absolutely no financial difficulties whatsoever. How sweet it must be. Her name is Sally. Sally made a fortune in the market. Even Dow Jones thought it kind of strange. When everything was dropping, her business was popping. She had the most desirable seat on the exchange. She got stocks and bonds from all the big execs. They gave her AT&T and IBM for a little S-E. Well, you're a great lip reader from the back. That old stock market treated Sally well. She knew just what to hold and what to say. When Bellin howled with prowl around her door, she knew what Mr. Bell was howling for. In her 10-room penthouse flat, she got rich as Rockefeller for being sweet to Roger's feet. On that muddy side of the street, at night she'd meet some papa and wake up with steel and copper. In the morning, Mr. Chrysler and DeSota love to watch your General Motor. Until dawning, in the Wall Street Journal on page 72, she's listed as a
public utility.
You know the song? Thanks to her profession, she avoided session. When McKesson and Robin came bobbing along, she kept messing with Robin and Robin McKesson. She go wrong with her romancing. She made a ransom 10,000 shares of Pittsburgh Glass. The way she traded, they said she made it on her consolidated gas. She told each Don Juan to get some up job. I thank you. Yes, Sally had a well-made flight. She got her gold out when Sally sold out all her America. All her America. All her American can. She beat the market with her all reliable plan. With dragon heart and brain a reed. What's the matter? Here's the matter. Here's the thing that's really wrong with me. Do you know what it means to miss New Orleans and miss it and day. I know I'm not wrong. The feeling's getting stronger the longer I stay away. Miss the moss-covered vine, the tall sugar pines, where mockingbirds used to sing. And I'd love to see the lazy Mississippi go hurrying in the spring. This next song, I love singing, written by my favorite lady composer. Amanda McBroom is here tonight, and I'm so thrilled. Amy Schoeffer-Hartman is here. And Shelley Markham wrote this tune with Amanda. And I think it's so important to sing songs. They give people hope. And this one certainly does. If I can get the mic in. When did that face appear in the mirror? The one just behind my shoulder. The one with time looking out of her eyes. The one that is me. Only older. When did that voice start to ring in my ear and whisper a sarcastic greeting? Here's to the rest of the days of your life, your skin tone, and chances of fleeting. What do I do with this knowledge that the seconds and minutes are dying? Think I'll spread out my arms and welcome the wind. That's the closest I'll get to flying. But I'm here for the long run. I've got songs left to sing. My heart is a strong one. It believes in just one thing. I'm still start speaking in tongues. Places and lovers remembered. When did I leave the land of the young? Becoming so roundly September. Was it the coffee? The brandy, the sex that caused this alarming condition? Can anyone tell me what's happening next? God knows I can't change this transition. I know now I'm better than I was before. Back when time and romance were for wasting. Just like a fine, expensive red wine.
Right. You got it.
So do you. And it's spring.
Yeah. Woo. Yeah. Woo. Yeah, baby. Bravo.
Woo. Right on. I love to sign Homer. It's just not fair that these fabulous people are beating us and leaving and leaving us behind. This is from one of his wonderful revivals of Little Me. I'm no chicken, but now and then I've got proof I'm no mother. I've got stories from way back when, but beat those spatter-tellers, fellas. Julie's here again, thank God. Don't ask the lady what the lady did before. Ask what the lady doing now. Don't poke around inside the lady's bureau drawers. What's here to thrill ya? Ain't memorabilia. Why drag the laundry out?
When you're about
to score. This touch-up lasts a week. Not a moment more. Don't ask a lady what the lady did before. Ask what the lady's doing. Speak up, you're a shoo-in. Ask what the lady's doing now. Don't diddle with chit-chat. Don't fiddle with small talk. What good is a fancy footwork if it's all talk? What
good? The trouble.
The trouble with men is, once the ice is thawed, they want to know, have you ever been abroad? Don't ask a lady when the lady had it last. Ask her if the lady wants it now. If you would know how the evening should be passed. Don't interview me. Just put it to me. That you are willing to. It's thrilling to the core. But make it fast. Before my facelift hits the floor. Don't ask the lady what the lady did before. Ask what the lady's doing before it all needs blowing. Ask what the lady's doing. Don't ask how well I'm doing. What other swell I'm doing. Ask what the hell I'm doing now. dark over there, I couldn't see you.
I couldn't see you.
That's all because of the wonderful Matt Hanks. Now, where is that adorable Skippy?
I'm right here, and I love you, honey, and you're great. Let's hear it out there. Julie Wilson, I love her.
And one more little song that I'd like to do especially for the ladies. We don't pay enough attention to ladies. And I want to share this song with you, and if you want to take notes, you want to call me up or have a talk to me about anything, please do. Yeah, I'd love to talk to you. I'm just so thrilled you're here. And Carrie Kelsey, my favorite blonde. I tell you, she gets prettier every year.
Oh, I love
you. I think
you.
I'm going to go blonde. I'm sick of this old dark hair. Well, I couldn't get my eyelashes on right tonight. One has one cup of blue, and the other one has some blue from another tube. It's frightening. With or without. All right, now. I used to wonder right along why I couldn't hold a man. Every love affair went wrong. Until I change my plan. I'm having no more trouble now. My daddy's nice. As he can be. And ladies and girls, I will tell you how. That's if you take a tip from me. Budget. Thank you, son. You know how you had always had a budget. And then go to Dunkin' Donuts. They have good black coffee, too. Bring it home and drink it out real fast. Now you awake. And then tell your baby. Tell your honey, baby's awake now. Ready when you are, Stevie. Well, you never know what's going to happen. Now you will lose him if you give him lollipops. When you know he's crazy just to have some chops. Find out what they like and how they like it. Let them have it just that way. Great idea. Girls, save up your pennies and your nickels and your dimes, even lucky pennies. Sing them up and take him on a cruise. A cruise has everything. Internet, Google. You could even do some Googling. Maybe find a new position. Maybe Google will come up with a new position. That might save your marriage. You never know. So if he says his laws, his meeting every night, then you know you're not doing all your Google. What? Find out what they like and how they like. So happy you're here. I'm happy Pat Morrison is here. Curtis Roberts and Amanda, Michelle, Carrie Kelsey, that gorgeous woman. All you wonderful people. And the light blinds me, so if I don't know you're here, hit me on the head or do something when I come on. But thank you for being such a glorious.
Never heard of Citizen Kane. It's the best film ever made. Voted by the American Film Institute. 100 best films. It's number one. And he said, you know, that one.
They've heard of
it. Well, he knew.
They've heard of my date with Ted Raymond.
Right. Well, and they've heard of the latest Carrot Top movie.
Yeah.
And
that's right. And that
other great one. Beavis Hall and the Dukes of Hazzard. That was a classic last year. And Bigelow, the European Gigolo. That was another classic. Yeah, there were some fine films. But
important
Citizen
film.
Haiti wasn't included in their list of the films that they loved. But that's just one person. One person's.
Yeah, cut it. Yes. You let me know, Gary. Huh?
Go ahead.
You want to count? You want to count or nothing?
Action.
Julie Wilson, I tell you, you were having such a good time here at that stage at the Gardenia here in West Hollywood.
Well, I certainly am, because the people here are so kind and such a wonderful audience. And I'm thrilled to came.
What is your secret of Julie Wilson at your age and been in show business throughout the whole world, entertaining? Julie, I'm looking at you. What is your secret?
I love it.
Is that it?
I love to perform.
You love what you're doing.
I do.
That is the most important thing.
I think it is, don't
you? It keeps you alive.
Yes.
And Cole Porter, when I use the word Cole Porter, tell me about it, the days.
Well, when he came to see me,
right,
and Pat Morrison was plugging for me to get the part
of Bianca and Kiss Me Kate.
Kiss Me Kate,
right.
And the national tour was Anne Jeffries, who's such a gorgeous woman too.
And she just had her birthday, I understand, today.
Well, she's
I love
wonderful.
Her.
I
yes.
love her too. I always have.
Uh-huh.
I love Pat Morrison.
Three elegant ladies.
Thrilled.
Come on, let's
there.
Face it. Anne Jeffries,
Pat
Morrison, and Julie Wilson.
Well, I'm proud
the three,
to be mentioned with them.
Three gorgeous ladies. I mean, that is really, really. Cole Porter must love sophisticated ladies.
I think he must have. And the things that he's written, nobody loves like Cole Porter.
Uh-huh. Lisa Kurt, what's happened with this great lady?
That she went to heaven.
I know she did, darling, but she was. Was your understudy or something like that? Or
no,
did,
no.
No? Okay.
We did the same part.
You did the same part.
She
yeah.
did the original.
That's what I meant. The original.
And I was the original national tour with
right,
Anne.
Right, right, right. Frank Gorshin, we just lost a wonderful mimic. I don't know if I'd say mimic. He had great
he
voices. He was in. He had many voices. In.
Yes, and he did a good job.
Yes, he did. And you did a show with him. With Frank Gorshin.
Yes.
And
it's called Jimmy.
Jimmy, that's it.
Jimmy
is the
light Walker
of the mayor of New York.
Yes.
Yeah. It was a fun show.
Yes, it was a fun show, and I was thrilled to be in it. But I see Anita Gillette sometimes in New York. And
right.
She would play the girlfriend. I played the over the hill.
Julie Wilson, I'm saying here, look at this club. This is a beautiful little club
Isn't
we have.
Dear?
Yeah, it's the only one in L.A.
Oh, I love it.
The only one. Why do you think this is the only dying?
Darling,
tell
I'm
me.
Thrilled it's here. I don't analyze. I just say thank you, dear Lord, for giving us this gift of having a wonderful gentleman like Tom Rowland keep this place going.
Tom Rowland was a dancer from New York.
And I was a dancer in the chorus at the Latin Quarter when he was there.
Were you at Latin Quarter? I didn't
yeah,
know
I
that.
Was before the Copa.
Really?
Yes, I was.
I didn't know. Wonderful,
well,
Julie.
See?
You are from the Midwest. Such
Omaha,
a,
Nebraska.
Nebraska. Why
and
are people...
so was Ruth Edding from
yeah.
Davidson, Nebraska.
Why are some people... friendly from Nebraska, Missouri, and Indiana. And
I know, we're just
they are friendly people,
way.
Aren't they?
And we go down the street, and if someone's walking there.
Say hi.
And it's late at night at 11 or 12,
uh-huh.
and dark, and the stars. I would say, hi, how are you doing? Today, and you're a total stranger, without any fear.
Right.
No fear.
Julie, do you have any fear about your life right now?
No, I'm just so grateful to be going and enjoying every minute.
You had your son in the audience tonight.
He is
Tell
a
me
great so, audience.
How do you feel having your son entertaining for these wonderful, chic, sophisticated, well, they're L.A., I know, but L.A. audiences.
I'm thrilled a bit. He just fits right in with everything. He's a great son.
Is he? And he's an actor, I understand.
Yes, a very good one.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
And his name is what?
Holt. H-O-L-T.
Uh-huh.
Is his first name.
Right.
And the second name was his late father's name, McCallany.
McCallany, I see.
But Holt changed the spelling to try to help people pronounce it.
Uh-huh.
It's M-C, and then a large C, A-L-L, McCallany, A-N-Y.
How did you meet your husband?
Well, through a friend in a New York deli.
Oh, okay. Okay.
And,
Julie, you gave up the business for a long time. It was very sad to hear that you had to leave the business to take care of...
I didn't have to do anything but pay taxes and die. And I didn't die.
No, you didn't.
No.
Not at all. But
no, but I wanted to be with my sons.
That's it.
When they were in high school. And I told them, I said, your mother's going to come home and just take care of the house and cook you dinner every night and just be a mom around the clock, so you better get used to it.
This is in Nebraska?
In Omaha.
In Omaha. Mm-hmm.
And my dad found me a darling little house,
uh-huh.
And he put the payment down for me. And it was a very small mortgage, and we had a wonderful time.
Did you miss it? Because you're such a cab. You know, I would consider you, would you say, cabaret performer?
Yes.
You are?
Yes.
A total cabaret performer.
Well, I started out
trying
to find my way, and I went to see all the greats, Sophie Tucker, Lena Horne, Dorothy Dandridge.
Sophie Tucker, Hildegard, yeah, right.
All the great ladies, and Mabel Mercer.
Oh, God, yes.
Favorite.
Mabel, yes.
Oh, and people.
Was that your favorite?
Oh, yes, she was so lovely.
Uh-huh.
I know, and Mitzi Green, I mean, I could go on forever.
Right, right.
And I always thought Lena Horne was so gorgeous, and she was always Dorothy Dad. But, and Phil Moore.
Right.
Helped me a lot. And Bobby Short was always so good.
Tell me about Bobby Short and...
Oh, we all miss him so much. He was New York to me.
Every time I think of you, you're a New Yorker. You're from Nebraska, but you are really a New Yorker.
Well, darling,
lady with this thing on your...
That was Billie Holiday, and I loved her. She was my very favorite.
Right.
And I knew she'd understand. And I feel honored to put on a gardenia.
Right.
And I think of her every day of my life. Whenever I work, and I have my flower, I think of Billie Holiday. She was so moving and so real and so nice.
So when you are making up in your dressing room back there, fixing up, the audience is waiting for Julie Wilson. What goes through your mind, Julie? Tell me.
Oh, things like,
you've been doing
please
it so
God,
many years.
Don't let my eyelash fall off. Oh, but I love to see other singers.
Yes.
I have so much fun.
They all come to see Julie Wilson.
They're very generous people. Cabaret people and ladies that sing and men that sing.
Uh-huh.
There's something about music that makes them generous and giving. People like Alan.
Right, Alan Eichler.
He's a good
He handles all these great singers.
I know, and he's very understanding.
Yes,
very
yes,
generous
yes.
too.
Yes, he is.
He's a good man.
Looking back over your career, Julie Wilson, would you say you had a good time?
Skippy, I've had a ball.
Really?
I have. I'm very
Have you written a book?
No, and I'm not.
Why? Why?
No, because I think it's very personal. And I feel like it belongs to me.
But you are sharing yourself.
I know.
But you are sharing yourself with that audience up there tonight. I sat here like a little boy, and you brought joy with showmanship,
oh,
finesse, little joy. And you gave me such pleasure, and I've seen the best. And you have that showmanship.
Well, so never. Do you, darling.
Darling. You'll never forget it.
You know,
Julie
you never
Wilson.
You Skippy Lowe.
Julie Wilson, you are the greatest, and I thank you so much.
Well, I'm
you're here. How many? How
I
long are you going to be here, darling? Here at the
Gardenia. Thursday, I have tomorrow night and Saturday.
And next week?
And then I have next,
Wednesday,
week. Thursday.
Okay,
Saturday.
Great. Thank you, Julie
thank
Wilson.
You,
I love you, and it was a great, the audience loved you. Thank
well,
you.
They couldn't have been nice.
Thank you, darling. Okay,
now,
she's going to come right over and talk to you.
Good.
Yeah. Hi, Julie.
Hi, Jill. Jill.
You're so beautiful and talented.
Well, look who's talking.
Oh,
look at this
aren't you a doll?
Wow.
And I love the songs that you sang.
Well, thank you.
And especially the ones that were more oriented toward the female
oh,
point of view.
Well, good.
But I want to ask you a question.
Go ahead. I said you could ask me anything.
Okay. I want to ask you a question about Skippy Lowe.
Okay.
And I want to ask you if you remember how you first met.
You know, it's been a long, long time.
Do you remember the earliest experience you had? Was it working together, or was it friendship, or at a party, or did you hang out with a group of friends, or?
Gosh.
Was it an interview by any chance on Skippy's wonderful show?
I think it was.
Yes.
I think it was an interview with Skippy, and I never forgot it. I wasn't a star. I was just a kid that was trying to get a foot in the door.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a brilliant agent manager called Baron Poland. And he brought me out to California and put me on Mickey Rooney's radio show. And I was given a prize to have 2 weeks of work. Employment at Charlie Morrison's Macumba nightclub. And I have to tell you, a very lovely lady came up to me last night. She's the only person has ever come up to me to say, I was at your opening night at Charlie Morrison's Macumba. And that was last night, right over there.
Oh, that's
I was
wonderful.
So thrilled. And I told her you were the first person to say that you had remembered me since 1948.
Oh, that's wonderful. That's a
and
great
then
story.
And my manager, Baron Poland, put me in the St. Regis Hotel in New York. And I went in for 2 weeks and stayed 4 months. And that got me started in the cabaret world.
So, do you recall where Skippy saw you, that he was able to ask you if you would be on a show?
I'm not sure. I'm not sure if it was...
Alan Eichen. Alan Eichen.
Well, maybe it was through Alan.
Yeah.
Alan Eichen was trying to help me and doing some press for me, and he was always pushing me. He gave me some those tapes that Billy Holiday had made. He was very sweet. And he was good to all the girls. And I must say, he was a generous, kind man. Always.
Yeah, that's what I understand, that he has brought back a lot of talent.
He has, and helped them survive.
And we need that. We need someone well,
we
to
all
make
need
the
a
initiation.
Help.
Make it happen.
I'd say anyone that has worked with him is very lucky.
I can't agree with you more.
Good.
Did you do more than one of Skippy's shows?
Yes.
Yes, I did several. And he was just part of my life. He was Hollywood to me.
Because it sure seems like you know him well, the way during songs, or I think it was between songs, actually, that you called out to Skippy and said, "Where are you?"
Well,
in the audience and all that.
He had called enough measure. I was staying with a singer friend of mine, a most lovely young singer, and she teaches. Her daughter's on the American Idol, and did her debut last night. And I would love to have been there to have watched it, but it's taped, so I will see her. And anyway, it was very exciting. And we had the same opening night.
Oh, that's wonderful. That's a great story.
Yeah, and Peaches has been such a good friend. And when I had a stroke a year ago, she came to New York and helped me and cheered me up and brought clothes for me to wear in the hospital, all those kind things that people do when they care about you. And she's a real bad.
And you seem like a very kind person to yourself.
Well,
that you've done a lot of things for a lot of people.
Oh, I don't know, not really. I just think I've been very lucky, and I want to give back.
That's good.
That's wonderful. Well, it's such a pleasure meeting
you. It's a pleasure meeting you.
Yeah. And I hope I get to see your show again and again.
Oh, yes.
And we must let everyone know when you're going to be performing.
So
again.
What are you going to be singing? So I can see.
Well, I'm not a singer, but
yeah.
I am an actress.
Well, just keep.
So I'll let you know when I'm going
well,
to act.
Oh, that would be. I never thought I'd be a singer. I wanted to be an actress.
Really?
Yes.
You would be your natural.
I don't know. I could just carry a tune in a bucket.
Look at her face. Look at how sculptured her face is. Is that beautiful or
right.
What? I mean, you're a natural to be an actress. You could start now.
Okay.
Well, if anybody would give me a part, I'd say yes.
Yes, okay.
Even if it's two lines.
Thank you, Julie.
Thank you so much.
Much.
Thank
wonderful.
Thank you. It was just a great evening.
Thank you very much.
Oh, our pleasure.
Thanks, Julie.
Thank you, Skippy.
Thank you, darling.
You're
thank
a
you.
Darling man.
Thank you.
And be where
careful.
Did you get...
for mass audiences.
The word that comes immediately to my mind is the word that was supplied to it, the factory. Isn't that strange? I think it was because MGM turned out such a tremendous product and they seemed to be geared for non-stop production.
Action!
They had the best arrangers and the best writers and the best costumers and set decorations and the finest directors. You wanted 10 dancers, they were 10 dancers under contract, the best they could find. You wanted 10 singers, they were there. Whatever you needed was at the fingertips of the producer.
The movie business became an industry in the 1920s. Every major studio was part of a larger company, and each company owned a chain of movie theaters nationwide. By 1930, business was booming. Over 100 million people were going to the movies once a week. Theaters couldn't keep showing the same pictures. That would have been like a TV series having the same episode every week. Supply had to keep up with demand. The Ford Motor Company provided the inspiration. Henry Ford tripled production of the Model T by using an assembly line. Hollywood became an industry when it jumped on that trend.
it was not called the motion picture industry for nothing. The key word is industry. It was a practical assembly line in every studio. The studio owned the theaters. They had to supply the product for the theaters. Picture played a week, it was a big picture.
Film companies began planning annual production quotas, manufacturing the product according to strict deadlines.
Each studio made on the average of a picture a week, about 50 pictures a year. So it had to be an industry, it had to be an assembly line. I think the wonder is that under those conditions, a few good pictures came out of it.
By the end of the 30s, the studio system was the preferred way to make movies, and quality often matched quantity. Here's a shooting schedule at MGM for the week of November 7th, 1941. It was quite a week.
Your personal studio visit to MGM's rehearsal hall to watch director Busby Berkeley rehearse the amazing youngsters of the screen.
Those amazing youngsters were Mickey Rooney and Judy Garland, winding up Babes on Broadway. Over on stage 16, William Powell and Myrna Loy were wrestling with another mystery in Shadow of the Thin Man. On stage 3, Katharine Hepburn and Spencer Tracy were rehearsing their first picture together, Woman of the Year. Next door, Robert Taylor was burning up the set with Lana Turner and Johnny Eager. Nelson Eddy and Risa Stevens were duetting in The Chocolate Soldier on stage 1. While over on stage 12, Johnny Weissmuller was hanging around a soundstage jungle on the latest Tarzan adventure. Imagine the same kind of activity going on every day at Warner Brothers, Universal, RKO. I mean, no wonder Hollywood was called a factory town. It was an assembly line, all right, but with a touch of glamour you just couldn't find in Detroit.
His name is Quiller. What do they want of Quiller? What does Quiller want of them? This man knows, but he won't talk. Not ever again. What do they want of Quiller? What does Quiller want of them? The answer is in the Quiller Memorandum.
He's dead. Another colleague of yours took over from him, Kenneth Lindsay Jones.
Mm-hmm.
He's dead too. He was killed 2 days ago. We'd like you to take over.
The Quiller Memorandum, a worldwide bestseller, hailed as the most exciting and suspenseful spy story in years, is now on the screen. And Quiller is a spy you can believe. Starring George Segal as Quiller, Alec Guinness as Paul, Max von Sydow.
My name's October.
October, a name to match the man.
You need to relax.
Cold.
They work you too hard.
Bleak.
That boss of yours, what's his name?
Terrifying.
Open your eyes. Begin your eyeballs, Quiller. Can you hear me? Begin!
What do they want of Quiller? does Quiller want of them? Senta Berger is Inga, very beautiful, very loving, perhaps very dangerous.
I'm worried about you, you know.
No need.
Oh, yes, there is. I know what they're like. He's told me what they're like.
You knew them?
Yes. He knew them.
Where is he, this man?
George Sanders is the man in London.
Any news from Berlin?
Robert Helpmann is the contact. Stop. Go.
Move over, please.
Stay close to Quiller. In the cat and mouse world of espionage, you have to use any bait you can find, even if you're it.
If you're still undecided by dawn, we will kill you both.
What do they want of Quiller? What does Quiller want of them? The answer is in the Quiller Memorandum.
This is the TCM Classic Movie News for January, the latest in entertainment news for the classic movie fan. In theaters this month.
The president, as you know, has a pretty darn good sense of humor. We'd like for you to go to India and Pakistan and tell us what makes the Muslims laugh.
Veteran actor, writer, and director Albert Brooks heads to India and Pakistan in search of what's funny in Looking for Comedy in the Muslim World from Warner Independent Pictures.
Why is there no Halloween in India?
Because they took away the Gandhi.
Brooks first captured viewers' attention, starring in films like Taxi Driver and Broadcast News, before going on to write and direct his own comedies. In his latest project, he's commissioned by the White House to help shape their foreign policy by finding out what the Muslim community finds humorous.
You're not a Jew, are you?
Not this minute.
West explodes with lyrical violence in Sam Peckinpah's legendary Westerns collection from Warner Home Video. From the graceful carnage of The Wild Bunch to the poetic allegory of The Ballad of Cable Hogue, the four-film set features Peckinpah's disillusion with the mythical West through a frenetic spectacle that garnered him the nickname Bloody Sam. For some family-friendly adventures, join us this month as we honor the prolific Japanese filmmaker Hayao Miyazaki with an animated film festival celebrating his collection of work. You can experience the magical adventures and imaginative storytelling that he brings to the screen every Thursday night in January on TCM. And you can pick up your own copy of the Hayao Miyazaki picture books with the filmmaker's vibrant cinematic world revealed page after page. Titles like My Neighbor Totoro and Howl's Moving Castle recreate the magical journeys of each of the animator's charming tales. And the story behind two classic performers is revealed. From Jerry Lewis and co-author James Kaplan comes Dean and Me, a Love Story. The book describes the hilarious and often tumultuous times Lewis shared during his 10-year partnership with Dean Martin, performing in clubs, on television, and in film. You can register for the chance to win a copy of the book, Dean and Me, by logging onto our website at turnerclassicmovies.com. While you're there, you can also purchase Sam Peckinpah's legendary Westerns collection at a special discount. And be sure to check out more TCM Classic Movie News in February.
Come one, come all, we're gonna have a ball. Just leave your cares and woes and let your troubles fall. You'll find a starry sky behind that cloud you're under. It's such a perfect time for one real wonders.
Thank you.
the murderous forces of war are unleashed in bloody rampage, the merciful symbol of the Red Cross marches with the dark legions of disaster and death. But in 1861, our own Civil War was claiming its thousands of victims. There was no Red Cross to render first aid to the wounded or to bring comfort to the dying. Countless men who might have been saved were left to die on shell-torn battlefields. Field hospitals, marked only with a yellow flag of pestilence, were too poorly equipped to handle the casualties of battle.
Follow.
Young man, will you please direct me to Dr. Bradley?
That's impossible, ma'am. The major's too busy now with operating to see anybody. Besides, my orders are not to let anyone in.
This kid's lost his arm, Bill, and he's bleeding fast. Better tend to him.
Operating tent's full up. He'll have to wait.
Wait? For what? Get some hot water, quickly.
But, ma'am, that's against regulations.
Regulations won't save this boy's life. Now, hurry! You see? Sometimes just such a simple gesture can save a human life. He couldn't have waited for the busy doctor.
You remind me of a school teacher I used to have. She said I was going to be a great surgeon because I had such keen eyes and careful fingers.
I will, too, if only this war would...
What's the meaning of this? Who's responsible for this breach of duty?
Dr. Bradley, this boy needs immediate attention.
What is more important, madam, is the reason for your presence here.
You seem to have great need of my presence, sir.
Our regulations are for a purpose. You must leave immediately, today. Are there any complications with this one?
I think it's tetanus, sir.
Nothing complicated, sir. Just simple murder.
Madam, I must say that such accusations are absolutely...
You're hiding behind a false duty, sir. Can't you see that your regulations are murdering the soldiers, believing them on the field?
Our sanitary commission is most efficient, and everything is being done possible under the circumstances.
So much so, I suppose, that you feel free to refuse the services of those who offer them. The circumstances are just blindness, sir.
Madam, we are wasting time. You will please return to the rear at once.
Advancing on along the line, Major. I want you to be ready. You're aware women are not permitted here, Major. I was just ordering her to the rear, sir.
Clara Garfield. I'm Clara Barton. It's you I must see.
Miss Barton insists, Colonel, on overlooking military discipline. Perhaps you can convince her her services are not needed.
I understand, Major. And I agree with you up to a point, Miss Barton. I must remind you that though our medical facilities are hampered, nevertheless, women are not permitted at the front. You must return at once.
What did I do with that pass?
As commanding officer, I refuse to honor any pass not issued by me.
Mr. Lincoln is, I believe, commander-in-chief. It's necessary for me to have a wagon and medical supplies and accommodations for myself and Elsie Howard, my companion. So, if you'll be so good as to assist me...
Madam, I am forced to concede. See that Miss Barton's wishes are carried out, Major.
Yes, sir. Conduct Miss Barton to 10-5.
Yes, sir.
Gentlemen, you've now learned how to be kind. Someday you'll learn the good of it.
You have a real stormy petrel there, Major. What is war coming to? Petticoats on a battlefield.
Had it not been for Clara Barton, a simple, modest schoolteacher who refused to be stopped by rigid army rules, the tragic fate of the wounded would have been far more terrible.
So much blood, poor boy, simply because there was no one to bring him in. Clara Barton. There, there. You're not alone anymore.
It's not that it hurts. It doesn't hurt much of any, but it kills. I know that. It kills, and I don't want that.
In the days to come, the wounded felt the aid of this new power who walked silently among the twisted shapes, calming and renewing the lives that had been wasted so carelessly.
We've all found a little comfort at last, Elsie. I think you'd better try and get some rest.
Now, you listen to me, Clara Barton. You haven't touched your head to a pillow for 3 nights. And if you don't...
There's so much to be done.
Yes. And you should have the strength to do it.
Ma. Ma.
Now, you must try to sleep. There's nothing to worry about.
I know, ma'am, but tomorrow the folks back home in Virginia will read I've been killed instead of a prisoner. I'm afraid my ma's kind of old.
Why not write to them?
with these?
Of course not. I'll write the letter myself and see that it gets through the lines.
Oh, no, ma'am. I don't think you'd better do that, thank you. Because, you see, I'm a Confederate. I'm a Johnny Reb, an enemy.
I know, Jeremy. I know. But when the battle's over, there are no more lines or sides. It's all the same.
I see. But, ma'am, why must they have all this killing to find that out?
That's right. Don't bother about it now.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Have you found out how many were hurt here?
We don't know yet, Doctor. Poor Jeremy. He never found an answer.
8 of the wounded were killed when a shell fragment hit the overflow tent.
They know there's a field hospital here. Why do they fire on helpless, wounded men?
Oh, I don't think they do it deliberately, but I guess nothing can be done about it.
You sound retreat too often, Doctor. When men create folly such as this, they learn to remedy it only when it strikes back at them, and it will. There should be some way. There must be some way. Some method of identifying hospitals, some emblem of mercy that both sides will respect. The wounded must be protected.
4 years later, Clara Barton made her pilgrimage to Switzerland, where two men, Henri Dunant and Dr. Louis Appia, had founded the Red Cross.
As you can see, Madame Barton, we have taken the flag of Switzerland, reversed it so that a Red Cross is upon a white field.
A red cross on a white field. Gentlemen, for 5 years I've been searching for just such an emblem.
The Red Cross is a sign under which we work. The white field must be the loyalty of all the nations of the world who will recognize that work.
I see. How many nations have signed the treaty?
21, madam. And we hope that our labors in the present war will draw more nations to us.
That is why Dr. Appia and I have come to ask your help. The United States did not as yet sign our treaty. We hope that by participating in our work, you will be able to tell your country how much the world has need of us.
I can assure you, gentlemen, that my every effort shall go into making it a reality in my own country. That you've asked me to serve under this sign fills me with a profound and humble gratitude.
Madame.
1870, the Franco-Prussian War, and Clara Barton, fired with new hope for a suffering humanity, served valiantly under the bright flag she adopted for her own. Organized her forces of mercy, cared for the children whose innocence was no protection against the monster of war. Then she was called to the International Meeting of the Red Cross in Geneva.
Miss Barton, the International Red Cross, wishing to recognize in some way the courage and loyalty you have given our cause, humbly bestows upon you this medal, the Geneva Medal of Honor.
Gentlemen, it's hard to understand why people are so easily convinced on matters of war, yet persuaded on movements of peace with such difficulty. But in my work with you, I've learned that the Red Cross is above the petty differences that divide men, is stronger than nationalities which seek a domination continually. And so, I feel that at this moment I may speak in behalf of my country. And I assure you that there will be no hesitancy about the United States giving you their complete support. My country will know how strong and how worthy is our purpose. And no obstacle will prevent me from being heard, even if I have to speak to the president himself.
Clara Barton returned to America and through 5 years of discouragement found surprisingly little interest in the Red Cross. Finally, she secured an interview with President Rutherford B. Hayes.
Your splendid work in Europe entitles you to every consideration, Miss Barton.
Thank you, Mr. President. I trust you have good news for me. on the ratification of the Treaty of Geneva?
I have here an answer from the Secretary of State Ellerts. This is his decision. Concerning the ratification by the United States of the Treaty of Geneva, I beg to inform you that this country's strict adherence to the Monroe Doctrine prohibits consideration of the treaty in question.
The Monroe Doctrine? What connection can the Monroe Doctrine have with human suffering? And what about peacetime mercy? Flood, famine, fire, epidemic, wholesale suffering from 1,000 peacetime causes. Mr. President, in every country in the world except the United States, the Red Cross has become the shield of civilization.
Such matters, Miss Barton, are of a complicated nature. But I can assure you that this decision is in the best interest of the United States. I'm sorry, but I'll have to substantiate the recommendation of Secretary Ellerts.
Finally, in 1881, when Garfield became president, Clara Barton sought once more an audience in the White House.
Well, if it isn't the Stormy Petrel herself.
As you see, General, I'm still trying to get somewhere without a pass.
Yes, and if I remember correctly, you'll get to wherever you've made up your mind to go.
You make it sound too easy.
Oh, I don't know. Things are too easy for you when it comes to twisting men around your finger. Well, if I don't watch myself, you'll be asking me permission to vote next.
Oh, you know perfectly well that politics to me is a game that little children play with long and short sticks.
All right, Clara, you win. But seriously, you have worked hard. And you've gone a long way since that time when I tried to convince you of our little war rules. After all, it is hardly a woman's task.
Yes, it's been hard. But sometimes we women can muster as much will to fight as you men, General.
Mr. President?
Yes?
Sorry to interrupt, but I must remind you, you have a train to make.
Oh, yes. Miss Barton, I want you to meet Mr. Robert Todd Lincoln, my Secretary of War.
My father often spoke of your work, Miss Barton. I remember he once said that it was only people like yourself that gave man the right to say he was made in God's image.
If it hadn't been for your father's faith in me, Mr. Lincoln, I might have wavered long ago. I'm only sorry. Everything seemed to be against our ever meeting.
Well, Clara, I must be off to New England. But before I go, I want you to promise to come to see me often. And, regarding your petition, you may be pretty sure that at last I think you've won.
You mean the treaty?
Yes. And furthermore, how would you like to be the first president of the American Red Cross? Come on, my friend.
I have dared to be a woman for nearly 20 years. I think I have the right now. And so, Elsie, just because for the past few years I haven't been able to keep up with the gossip, you give it to me all at once.
Now, you know very well, you were the one who pried it out of me.
Now, stop being silly. Drink a cup of hot tea, it'll cool your tongue.
Oh, look who's coming, Dr. Bellows. With a face as long as a pair of winter underwear.
Good afternoon, Doctor. We were just talking about you.
We said we hope you don't visit your patients with that long face. They'd prefer to be sick.
Miss Barton, I would rather have found you in a less jovial mood.
Oh, you would you? Nothing could depress me today, I'm afraid.
Have you seen the papers?
Oh, now we're going to have some more gossip. What is it, Doctor?
This morning at the Union Station, President Garfield was shot.
President James Garfield was shot today while standing in the Baltimore and Potomac Railway Station.
Something beyond our human comprehension. There never was a kinder man. Washington, December 12th, 1881. Dear Miss Barton, urgent business of great importance compels my immediate attention, leaving me unable to fulfill at the present time the pledge given to you by President Garfield. Trusting you will bear with this unavoidable delay, I remain yours sincerely, Chester A. Arthur, President of the United States.
Clara Barton retired to her home, where she sought by writing pamphlets to tell this nation of the purpose and sincerity of her organization.
Right,
A very important dispatch, Major Barton.
Oh, thank you, Johnny. Did your father send you with this?
Yes, right off the wire.
Oh, must you be so terrifying, Johnny?
A soldier has to be, ma'am.
It's from Washington.
Didn't I say it was important?
Washington, D.C., March 16, 1882. It is my great privilege to inform you of the ratification by the United States of the Geneva Treaty. I have this day appointed you the first president of the American Red Cross. My sincere congratulations, Chester A. Arthur, president of these United States.
Oh, Clara, you've won. You've won at last.
Elsie, now that the news has come at last, I feel suddenly, for no reason at all, afraid. Our work has just begun.
Born of battle, the American Red Cross was soon fighting the grim disasters of peace. 1884, when the mighty Mississippi, flooding its banks, unleashed its turbulent force. 1885, famine in Texas. 1886, the earthquake in Charleston. The great blizzard of 1888. 1889, the Johnstown flood, when the horrible holocaust of raging waters joined the forces of destruction and death. 1892, the famine in Russia. 1898, the Spanish-American War. And once more, Clara Barton, with mercy and courage, carried the Red Cross to the shell-torn battlefield. 1900, when the ocean swept over Galveston. In all these disasters was Clara Barton, a living symbol of the Angel of Mercy. And finally, on April 12, 1912, this great and noble woman came to the sunset of her life.
Yes, all my friends are with me at last. Those that have gone before, I just can't see them yet. That's all. There's General Garfield. He knew well the cruelty of guns. And there... Oh, there's Jeremy. We haven't answered his question yet, but we will. The faces of men on the fields of battle. The eyes of little children whose homes a river swept away. Well, they're all there. They're all here now. The fire of life must be dropped behind us all sometime. I have to leave it now. But it won't be alone. For I know that there are others that will faithfully come forever and ever and never let the flame die. For you see, my friends, it's the fight against pain that keeps us all together. And in that symbol of the Red Cross is the meaning of that peace which men must be able to enjoy. The flag of humanity.
This month at TurnerClassicMovies.com, we celebrate the art of Japanese animator Hayao Miyazaki of Spirited Away fame with a festival of his movies, in-depth articles, film clips, photos, and a sweepstakes. Our book corner selection for January is Dean and Me, Jerry Luce's memoir about his friend and comedy act partner Dean Martin. And check out our January DVD sale where you can save up to 40% off classic titles like High Sierra and new releases such as the Sam Peckinpah Legendary Westerns Collection. It's all happening in January on TurnerClassicMovies.com.
Grace Kelly,
Spencer Tracy,
Vincent Minnelli, typical Hollywood story.
Damn good actress.
In order to test for the yearling, I had to bleach my hair. And so I bleached my hair and I went out, no makeup, no anything. She was a very earthy woman. And that was something new for me because I was always a city girl, you see.
What you grinning at?
Well, nothing.
I look all right?
You look just dandy, sweetheart.
In the meantime, I have to come back to Warner's because they're not ready for the yearling yet to do Night and Day.
Cole!
Gracie! How do you feel?
Oh, Minky.
So I'm doing both shows at the same time and talk about both ends of the piano, you know?
Now, all you have to do is be amusing and don't say a word.
Well, usually I was the girlfriend. You know, like Eve Arden and I were always somebody's friend, you know, or holding the bag for somebody, like second banana, you know. Oh, patience is something that I was never really endowed with. But patience of working with that deer and working as those long hours taught me so much.
Tracy, you're wonderful. You're different. What happened?
I suffered.
The ever-versatile and beautiful Jane Wyman celebrates her birthday Wednesday. Tune in for a day of her films beginning at 6 a.m. Eastern here on Turner Classic Movies.
Hi, I'm Robert Osborne, and here's to a very happy, healthy, and prosperous New Year's. Perhaps filled with everything good you'd like to have come your way. Maybe even a few treasures, like the ones people are after in our next pair of films. We're about to bring you two adventure films which revolve around the Arabian Nights hero, Sinbad. And we begin with a Technicolor spectacular from RKO in 1947 called Sinbad the Sailor, starring Douglas Fairbanks Jr., Maureen O'Hara, and Walter Slezak. This was, by 1947 standards and by RKO standards, a very costly film to make, loaded as it is with lavish sets and a top-drawer cast, including Anthony Quinn, when he was still playing villains, and it also has Jane Greer, the same year she menaced Bob Mitchum in Out of the Past. Now, the Technicolor work in this film was done by the much-respected cinematographer George Barnes, the same George Barnes who won an Oscar for his black-and-white cinematography on Hitchcock's film Rebecca, and whose work in color included Cecil B. DeMille's Samson and Delilah and The Greatest Show on Earth. Ours was a particularly important film for Douglas Fairbanks Jr. He was not only taking up his father's swashbuckling legacy, but also making his first film after returning from 5 years of active duty in the Navy during World War II. He'd been concerned that he'd been away from movies for so long that he might not have much of a career to come back to. But to his surprise, RKO offered him this film, which was actually bigger than anything he'd done before the war. And it immediately established Fairbanks back in the Hollywood front ranks. Here from 1947 in dazzling Technicolor, RKO's Sinbad the Sailor.